going to talk to you about some stats, but don't be scared of these stats. They ain't that hard. You know how many statistical problems I'm going to ask you to answer? How many mathematical equations I'm going to get you to memorize on the test? None. So all you math phobes, relax. Because you don't have to do math to understand the implications of statistics. I don't have to hand calculate any of the statistics that I use in my science. I have a software that does that, right? I push a button. Now, I need to know how to collect the data. I need to know how to organize it in a database. And I need to know what button to push under what circumstances. And I need to be able to interpret the output, right? But in terms of actually doing the math myself, I don't do the math myself. But knowing what it means is really important for us all as a society. It's very important. So we're going to talk about some descriptive statistics. One is called central tendency. That's just a term. Based on a normal distribution. Everybody's familiar with the bell curve, yep? You know the bell curve. And people talk about getting graded on the curve. That is a misunderstanding of the curve. You don't want to be graded on the curve. Being graded on the real curve means that the grades fit a normal distribution. About 10% of people going to get an A, about 10% of people going to get an F, maybe 20 get a B, 20, you see what I'm saying? And most people going to get a C, because that's what a normal distribution looks like. When they talk about grading on the curve, what they mean is, oh, the highest test score in the class was a 90, so I'm adding 10 points to everybody's score. Right? That's a test correction. That's not grading on a curve. Right? That's making up for measurement error in the test, and many of the people giving the test don't know what measurement error is in their test, so they call it curving the test, right? You now know different. Central tendency says that we got some understanding that if we have a normally distributed set of data, we can see various kinds of statistics will tell us how that data looks. Just looking at these statistics right here. So what is mean? I don't know why they call it mean. I don't know why they make statistics hard to understand. I don't know why they use a bunch of Greek symbols. Just call it average. It's the average. Everybody knows what the average is. We're going to call it the mean. No, it's X bar. I get that you can't write out average at equals every time. So X bar makes some sense to have some symbols. But for a lot of people, they see it and they go, that's all Greek to me and I ain't doing it. They get scared of it. Don't be scared of it. The average, right? What's an average? You know what an average is. The numerical average of the data set is the sum of all of the measures divided by the number of the measurements. And a lot of people think that tells them all kinds of stuff. A lot of times it tells you the wrong stuff. The mode is not a great measure of central tendency. I learned last semester when a student who was interested in mathematics challenged me on this after class, and I say thank you to him, right? Jason came up to me, he said, I'm in a stats class, and my stats professor said, mode's not really a great measure of central tendency. I'm like, really? Because it's in all the books, and I've been learning it since 1992 that it is. I said, but that's a good point, let me check that out. And I went to one of our stats people, psychology stats person, I said, mode, good measure of central tendency? He goes, not really. But it does tell us something about the data set. And that's what we're trying to understand with the data set. The mode is the measurement of value that occurs most often, most frequently. The problem with it is you could have two modes that occur most frequently. Theoretically, you could have three or four or five values in the data set that occur with equally high frequency. And you might have another value that only occurs with one less frequency of less, one less. And now we don't look at that because it's not the mode. So keeping in mind that mode does tell us something, what it tells us is what is the most likely value in the data set. And believe me, I'm going to tell you why this matters in a minute. Just ride with me for a sec. And then we got a median. That's the middle of the data set. When I put it in order from the lowest value to the highest value, if there's 100 values, right, then the one in the middle is going to be the one that I'm interested in. If it's even, then I got to average the two numbers in the middle. If it's odd, it's the number right in the center. That's where, if I have it all lined up, the middle person will be found. Now, if it's a perfectly normal distribution, then my average ought to be there, my mode ought to be there, and my median will, of course, be there, right? Because that is a perfect example of normal distribution. But it turns out, when you talk about human beings, oftentimes you get skewed distributions. Now, you know as well as I know, people go, well, the median income in Johnson City is this, or the median number of cars owned by people is that. And they act like that means something to lay people, right? And they just go, oh, that's the middle, right? Well, it is the middle, but we don't know anything else about the spread of the data yet, do we? Right? Or worse yet, they go, well, the average is this. But we don't know what the standard deviation is, and most people don't know what the hell a standard deviation is to begin with, right? So mean can be dragged by outliers. Y'all know what outliers are? Those are extreme values in the data set. Let's say, for example, that my mode will be 20,000. That most people in my data set in Johnson City, can I get everybody in my data set? How much they earn in a year? Exactly? No. But let's say I have a large enough group that I can ascertain, I don't know, 20,000 data points, for example. And I find that the most frequently occurring number is 20,000. I go, oh, that's good. That's, I understand now, right? That's what most people make around here is 20,000. Maybe, with my mode being there, maybe my median's even there. But let's say Bill Gates moves into town and he gets in our sample. And let's say he's making a few billion a year. Now all of a sudden I got an average that might be 60,000 or more. I don't know. I'm not doing the math in my head, right? So if I was ignorant of the sample and the means to collect the data, and I looked at this average that somebody's showing me on the news and saying, well, the average salary in Johnson City, $60,000, people are doing pretty well around here. And I didn't know that there was outliers in that data set. I would have a squarely incorrect view of the data of Johnson City, right? I would then be basing all actions that might come forth from that number on an erroneous conclusion about the data. Because now I got this severe outlier dragging the mean way up. That if I remove that outlier, it will come back down to normal. So in knowing the mean, I also want to know other factors about this central tendency so that I get a better understanding of things. You look on the news tonight or tomorrow and see if you don't see somebody talking about an average of this or a median of that and saying nothing else about it. That's it. That's all they're going to say. And they're just going to walk off like that's the most important thing you need to know. But it ain't. The most important thing you need to know is how did they design the study? How did they acquire the sample? How did they do their statistical analyses? And by golly, what is your central tendency marker besides mean or median? I want to know other things about it. And I particularly want to know, and I won't make you know the variability, the range, the deviation, variance, but from the variance, some of the square deviations of the number of measurements from their mean divided by n minus 1 gives me the standard deviation. And it's got this little symbol beside it. That's what that symbol means. Like X bar means mean, means average. This little thing right here, what is that called, y'all? Huh? Okay. I call it a little cannon. The little cannon means standard deviation. Right? You could call it sigma, or you could just say it's that little thing that means this other thing. You could write it SD, standard deviation. Standard deviation is something you should know as a citizen. It's going to make you a much more informed consumer of information. When people start spouting the mean, the first thing you should ask them is, what's the standard deviation? And they're going to go, huh? Because if they don't know, then you don't know a lot about this data set that you need to know. So the positive square root of the variance is not what I want you to know for the test. What I want you to know for the test is this. What does standard deviation means? I don't care that you know how the thing is derived. Once it's derived, though, and we have some faith that it was done correctly, I want you to know what it means. And that's important. So the normal distribution here will tell us that about 68% of the measurements will fall within plus or minus one little canon of the mean. Right? Plus or minus one sigma? Is that what it was? Is that what you called it? Of the mean. Plus or minus one SD of the mean. Plus or minus one standard deviation of mean. Meaning that most of the measurements will fall within plus or minus one standard deviation of mean. Now we're going to talk about that more detailed. You should know that 95% fall within plus or minus two standard deviations of the mean. That's almost everybody, isn't it? But it ain't everybody. It's not everybody at all. There's people who are going to fall outside of plus one or plus two standard deviations or minus two. But if I get out as far as plus or minus three standard deviations of the mean, I'm talking about 99.7% of all the measurements. If I can assume that this is a truly representative sample, and that's a big assumption, one that you'd want to check out before you start taking on faith what people are saying about their study, that's almost everybody. But it's still not everybody, right? So if I look at that, I'm left with 0.3% that is going to fall outside of plus three standard deviations or minus three standard deviations. And in that sense, I want to be understanding what my mean is because I got to subtract from it or add to it to know what that range is. If the sample is representative of the population in question, and as I said the other day, it depends on what you're interested in measuring, right? Might be toddlers, might be college students, it might be people who consume mental health care or physical health care or whatever it is. But assuming that you have enough of a sample of the population, your data should conform to these normal distribution rules. And we'll do it again next time. I'll see you all on the Friday coming up. All dressed up, I hope. Maybe even bringing some food. Y'all have a good day.